Richard Bellamy asked me to give this talk, and when I said, well, I mean, what sort of thing do you have in mind? He said, well, you know, obviously maths over program is pretty important. And so that's why, in fact, on this occasion, I'm adopting a format which for me is, well, I'm not saying unusual, very unusual indeed, which is that of commemoration. Clearly, my normal work is purely, or if you prefer, absolutely historical. Perhaps all the few things I may think show from the world of certain granite-like nauseating obstinacy about certain things. In this case, I'm sort of slightly going to bend into my principles and pretend, at least for a moment, we should talk about the present day as well. The great problem with Weber that Diego has alluded to is precisely that. Of course, everybody has a great interest in him, but they come at him, of course, from very different perspectives, and they take very different things away from him. They read very different texts. And the great problem with Weber, if you are a historian, but also a commemorator, how do we construe Weber as a single individual, as a unitary individual? And this is, of course, not an unreal task in any sense, precisely because, as an individual, he made such an enormous impression on his contemporaries. Nobody's in any doubt at the time that he was a real individual. He was, you know, an individual in spades. This is really where I'm coming from. This is why not only is he a good subject for historical analysis, but indeed I think an important subject for us to try to reflect upon, and I really do mean all of us should be trying to reflect upon why we might think Max Weber is a significant presence in 2014. My preliminary answer to this is to suggest that Weber is, in principle, still a universal thinker. I don't just mean by that he had a simply extraordinary range, although he obviously did, and that's not irrelevant. Saying there's something in common between Weber and Hegel, or Weber and Leibniz, isn't a foolish thing to say, and therefore most certainly there is an important cultural continuity there. But the point I wish to dwell on is the fact that Weber is upholding a set of universal categories in a modern world where, by and large, universal categories simply don't work. So I'm going to start off with, as it were, a little bit of historical context, if I may, trying to suggest in what ways what I'm calling universal values were breaking down at precisely the moment of Weber's cultural formation in the late 19th century. Self-evidently, a polarity between the real divisions in existence and the more or less spurious universal categories that contemporaries have erected. That sort of polarity has always existed. At the Reformation, nobody was going to admit there was a problem with religious difference and pluralism, but there obviously was. Do you see what I mean? A modern would say, good Lord, why didn't just everybody grow up and accept that pluralism? Clearly, as Luther and Calvin and the Council of Trent could not do that. What I want to suggest is, therefore, that it's in late 19th century Germany that you reach a sort of tipping point where it's not that people want to admit that universally valid categories have broken down, but nonetheless, acknowledgement that there is a problem is beginning to reach a level of volume, both in noise terms and quantity terms, that can hardly be ignored. In other words, what's coming, what's emerging, are a set of forms of acknowledged difference. As I said, most people say, having been faced by these problems of difference, they say, well, of course, we now we know what they are, we can overcome them. But the initial point I wish to make to you is precisely that these forms of difference are emerging. So, as far as Weber's concerned, for example, he's born, as Diego Stoppel said, in 1864. Germany is, in heavily inverted commas, unified in 1866/1871. But anybody who knows anything of the political history or social history of Germany down to 1914 will know that, in fact, so-called unified Germany wasn't actually very unified at all. This is a quotation from the handout. In just to show the Weber news. Quote, Bismarck's life work ought to have led not only to the external but the inner unification. But we all know this has not been achieved. And what you actually have in the Bismarckian Reich are a set of what they call communities of Kultur, i.e., communities of the crude translation of Kultur is of value. So you have, for example, Catholics, you have socialists, you have liberals, and you have a very bizarre number of all sorts of reactions. But you do have this sense of a sort of plurality which is really not under control. That's one form of difference. Another form of difference, infinitely more trendy, and I'm sure much better known in all sorts of ways to a modern audience, is the sort of difference that comes along with the tag Nietzsche. That is to say, Nietzsche must be taken as a symbol or symptom of a situation where people are beginning to question the idea of the need of any uniformity of values in personal lifestyle. Is it really necessary to believe in God most famously? But again, as I'm sure you know, the readers of Nietzsche read very rapidly on to the fact that, well, you know, if you don't have to be a Christian, why the hell do you have to be a heterosexual? Or again, of course, the Nietzsche vogue is heavily implicated in questions of aesthetics. I'll throw this in for the benefit of intellectual history. Weber was utterly contemptuous of this. He says, we live in an age of subjectivist culture. In other words, everyone just thinks what they want. And he really does agree with this. He thinks this is very frivolous. And there's a very, very famous, when I say famous, well, readers of Protestant, I'm sure you all are, when Weber asks, who are the people who might live in steel houses, Stahlhaus, the boys in the future? And one of his suggestions is there will be a convulsive self-importance. And it took me years to work out what the hell he meant by that. And what he meant by that was the Me Too generation, where everybody took their personal identity very, very seriously indeed. But that was another form of difference. And of course, a difference that we have no difficulty in recognizing today is absolutely contemporary. A third form of awareness of difference, which is extremely important for Weber, which he does not look on with contempt at all, but in fact with utmost respect, is in fact cumulative historical study across the whole of the 19th century. But the sort of the part he calls it, this practically stuff out of a sort of a school textbook. He says the awakening of the historical sense. I wonder how many school textbooks have been written about German culture in the 19th century to say that. But this is very, very important. It's precisely, in fact, in the 1890s that people begin to realize what the implications of this torrential volume, an ever expanding volume of specialized scholarship is in history. And of course, it is the conclusion they have reached, this conclusion which now to us is so self-evident it's polite not to mention it, which is, of course, history is just an infinity. what is the lesson of history is that absolutely everybody does everything differently according to their own value systems. And this was the original meaning of the much debated word historisms. Historisms becomes a vogue word in the 1890s, and it really does mean just unadulterated historical relativism. Weber himself refers to, I quote, the cold breath of historical mutability. It's a very, very vague Weber sort of phrase. Mutability is creeping up. I suppose he perhaps could have been a horror picture director. And it's awesome. Anyway, so these all forms are cultural context of where it's not just that difference exists, but people are beginning to accept that they have to discuss it. This is no longer negotiable. You can't just brush it under the carpet. There's a fourth form of difference or fragmentation, which is much more personal to Weber himself, but is undoubtedly used by Weber in this context. And this is the idea of developing specialization function over time. The idea that, in fact, the world is splitting into more and more specialized functions. Rather curiously, when we consider the reading history of the Protestant ethic, most people think Protestant ethic is about either capitalism or Protestantism. They forget that, in fact, the principal argument of Protestant ethic is an argument about the specialization of function. That's what the Weberian behoof or calling is. Weber is evoking to the person who believes that their job is, and I quote, an absolute end in itself. And you need to think about that, because, you know, this is really, it could be talking about an ascetic Protestant in the 17th century, but it could be talking about corporation man in the 1960s as well, or indeed corporation man in 2010. So the sheer importance of specialization of Weber is very, very important. And here again, the whole idea is an idea of compulsory, necessary narrowness. And with the result that in a specialized world, you have to accept your horizons narrow, and that in fact, actually, there's all sorts of other specializations living alongside you, which are equally necessary. And this too, of course, is a form of difference. Now, the thing which is, I think, crucially distinctive about Weber is this, that without exception, you know, it's rare for historians to say that, but I will say that, without exception, all his contemporaries, including all the most trendy and advanced and clever people, when confronted by this problem, are very worried. In a very convenient and helpful phrase, Ernst Troeltsch, who I'm sure many of you know, is very closely connected to Weber, he calls it the anarchy of values. And when he says anarchy, you know, you can tell he's shit scared. You look at the philosopher Wickert, you look at the old Zimmer, you can go back to Nietzsche himself. All of these people can see that there is this fragmentation of values and fundamental assumptions, and they don't like it. Clearly the point is to surmount the problem. You know, if you're Nietzsche, okay, well then you have to have humanism. And so on. You know, if you're Troeltsch, you have somehow got to overcome historism and recreate a modern Christianity. You know, the fact that you happen to die before you get there, well, that's accident. The difference with Weber is that Weber doesn't think like that. Weber simply says, yeah, okay, this is how it is. And this is an absolutely fundamental point. This is the very, very first quotation of the handout. Which is, in fact, as I've said, it's limited in Goethe's past, but they, in fact, has managed to rewrite the text without actually changing the letter, but not anything. You can tell what he says. The new urge awakes. I hurry forward to drink the eternal light. Whereas the eternal light in Ghosh is, as some imagine, Goddess. In Veda, it is the eternal light of the great problems of Kultur. The fact that Kultur is constantly changing, that values, absolute values, are constantly changing. And then Veda gives this wonderful description of this situation. Before me the day, behind me the night. Behind me is what is now for date. And then the heavens above, and of course, that's quite interesting, the word Himmel is perfectly ambivalent in this context. Does it mean heaven? Something theological. Or does it mean sky? We don't know. But even say that's somewhere up there anyway. So the heavens are above, and then beneath me, this is what Sir David so well, the waves. The crucial point is modern life, no, you're not on firm ground. You are on waves. But hell, be a windsurfer. Enjoy it. Yeah? You see, that's why the image suits you so very, very well. You know, yes, it's a sea. We're sailing on the sea. Sailing is fun. And this is absolutely unique. And I cannot stress to you how unique this is. That there is absolutely no one who understands this in Weber's own day. Church is, without question, the most sophisticated reader of Weber. And Church, to give the man credit, is totally honest about this. He says, I absolutely don't understand. He calls Weber a heroic skeptic. Siegfried Krakauer calls him a moral desperado. And Krakauer, again, we're talking about, you know, very up-to-date, really deep, trendy guys. You know, but Krakauer says, Weber is a desperado. You know, and Krakauer's a genuinely trendy man. Anyway, okay, so, the question we have to consider about, you know, the relevance of Max Weber in 2014 is then becomes a very large question. And the large question is, okay, how does he cope with fragmentation? And there are, therefore, a whole series of areas where we can look at this. Number one, which is what I'm going to talk about this afternoon, is Wissenschaft, the whole academic project. Number two and three are what Weber draws upon as sources of universal categories, which is religion and law. And number four is the one area which is obviously not universal, which is politics. So that in principle we could have had four lectures. But you know how these things are, you know. Somebody asks you when you give a lecture, and you say, I'll give a lecture. And you know, once you've been working for about 3 weeks, you realise that in fact it's four lectures. And that's why, alas, this afternoon we may need this in charge. But of those four, in no way the least important. I suppose it's fair to say that Weber's writings on, as I said, this is not the academic project, whatever you want to call it, are very well known and very highly regarded. I would certainly say, and I would stress that, you know, it's crucial in historical scholarship, you should not have any ethical commitment on behalf of your subject whatsoever. But I would say if there was one Weber text I thought was worth saving from the deluge, it would be science's vocation. But let us go on and therefore think a bit about this word. I said the English word, the English translation of science, is simply inadequate. That we need to have some sensation, which I'm sure, as practicing academics, we do have this sensation, even if we don't necessarily always put it into words. We need to have some sensation of the collectivity of the entire academic project. And this is a crucially important point. Now, as we all know, that Weber wasn't, I think, in all sorts of ways, particularly good European, so not in a political sense. But Weber is a very good European. He's an obvious globalist in terms of Wissenschaft. You know, the academic project is, as far as he knows, it is everywhere. And you need to have some sense of the sheer grandeur. Interest. So, allow me to quote from my own script. Wissenschaft is the entire realm of disciplined knowledge about man and the world. It is about not merely the condition. generate knowledge is not only about research, it is about communication and tradition. And this is, if I may say so, and dare I say, perhaps particularly to an audience such as this, this is very, very important. Wissenschaft does not live by research alone. Wissenschaft only lives by research and communication. And Weber understood that, much as he hated lecturing to students, Weber did understand that absolutely. There are many ways we could capture the magnitude of Weber's conception of Wissenschaft. Readers of science vocation, I'm sure that's probably most of the people in this room, will know he has a conception of Wissenschaft as something that began in ancient Greece and had a continuous and, be it stressed, autonomous history all the way through to his own day. Yes, Wissenschaft was not created by Ghosh, for example. So Wissenschaft spans all times, and perhaps even more people, certainly more extended peoples. Now, the problems presented by this developing sense of fragmentation that I was talking about are, of course, clearly apparent in what Weber has to say about Wissenschaft. For example, when he's talking about how people have different values, actually most of the most famous illustrations actually come from his writings about teaching and research. He gives you an example of, for example, can the Freemason and the Catholic understand each other? And then he says, can the French and the German understand each other? That's in 1919. And then, of course, even more famous, well, even famous, and equally relevant, I think, again, I'm sure we all feel this in some sense. It says, Wissenschaft, the fruits of Wissenschaft must be accessible to a Chinese. And that wasn't vague just for saying, ah, yes, I know the Chinese economy is going to come on strong after 1980. That is Weber, the man who is quite explicitly and realistically and unapologetically an Occidentalist, nonetheless saying the framework of Wissenschaft has got to go further. Even in his own day, let's be honest, he's seen the 1911 revolution, China's in meltdown, but Wissenschaft still has to be accessible to Chinese. And this is important. The second disintegrative force, which is obviously of the utmost importance in this context, and again strikes home, I believe, to all of us, is of course Weber's very, very preoccupied with the question of specialization of Wissenschaft, of both knowledge and teaching. Again, what's very interesting is that Weber believes that both in research and teaching, specialism must be accepted. Just as the conflict and the cross-cultural anarchy of values must be accepted, equally, you can't be a King Canute here. You can't fight history. If you've got specialization, there's no point in sort of saying, oh dear, I'm ethical and universalist, so I can't stand it any longer. You have to wrestle with specialization. As do we all. In all honesty, that's the sort of the typical Weber message, which is so obviously relevant to 2014. No easy solutions. For God's sake, pull up your socks. A third important context for Wissenschaft, which I haven't so far mentioned, but again is very obvious, is that Weber understands, of course, that it has an institutional context. You cannot understand either teaching or research except with an institutional context. The idea that you can write about epistemology without the social science context is nonsense. I don't know how many epistemologists there are in the room. Personally, I yawn to that. It seems to me practically self-evident. Very interestingly, when Weber is trying to describe the institutional context in science as a vocation, he says, this is very interesting, the context is, I quote, capitalistic, and at the same time, bureaucratized. And also very, very beautiful about that, any reader of Weber will know, Weber oscillates a bit, etc., saying, well, is modernity more about bureaucracy or is it more about capitalism? And in 1919, when he's talking about Wissenschaft, he's saying, well, there's some capitalism here and there's some bureaucracy here. That's in itself is an interesting story. It also has another very important point, which again is crucial for Weber, which is that academic research should in no way be cut off from ordinary life. This is absolutely crucial. Biographically, it comes back to the point that Weber in the 1890s was not at all sure that he wanted to be an academic. As far as he's concerned, being an academic is just one form of specialised function. And you see, the analysis of specialisation in modern ethics is called specialisation throughout society. Whereas specialisation within the academic arena is just a fragment of specialisation. So as I said, Weber, this is extremely in my view, perhaps this is a personal view. Oh, absolutely, we're going to have to allow value judgments to come in here. In my view, that's right, that's correct. And let us be honest, it's a dating phase. It is a dating phase. So, sticking with Max Weber, how does he cope with the forms of disintegration? Well, the first thing is, it's very easy, if you have the formula there, where it's all about rationalisation, it's all about steel housing, life's getting grimmer, it's all about bureaucracy. But what we must never forget, and in fact the role this plays in discussions about research and teaching is actually particularly expanded. For Weber, in fact, in one sense, of course, agrees totally with all his conservative contemporaries and the, in some sense, agrees with him, because he believes totally that people's conduct begins with values, with absolutely held values. In that sense, you could say he's a complete conservative. And this then comes back, this then raises the question, well, why doesn't he have this sort of phobia about disintegration nobody else does? And there are various ways of doing this. One is what I've already mentioned, which is that as far as Weber is concerned, what historical research shows is that values have always been mutable. In other words, it's true, we may only just be waking up to it now, but it's not a new state of affairs at all. You see what I mean? And therefore, for that reason, in fact, actually, well, if they're mutable, they're mutable, and in fact, the whole of the past history was living in that situation, whether it was aware of it or not. So, in fact, it isn't that, it shouldn't be that frightening. The second way Weber, the second source of Weber's quite positive response to the sense of disintegration is, as a matter of fact, Weber, again, in another very conventional sense, is a very good mainstream liberal individualist. He believes in the ethical autonomy of the individual, Mr. Cliché. You will remember, trust you all will, where after all, where did Weber and individualism come from? Well, one of its sources, anyway, was, and I quote, unillusioned individualism of the Puritans. And there's no question whatsoever that Weber thinks that people who have values and who, like the Puritans, are prepared to prove they've got values and, like the Protestant sects, prove before their peers that they have values. This is what it's all about. This is what the proper person is. But there's nothing in all of that which says that the values have to be immutable. Although it is true to say, of course, the Puritans were operating on one conventional set of Christian values, so that there's that point at which he lets the Puritans go. And it's quite interesting when Weber's talking in an education context. Again, I'm sure many of you who've read about Weber in America will know this. Weber actually, you know, he's fascinated by American education. Of course, some is so religious still. You think, what is going on here? I'm practically reliving what's there. And in that sense, as you know, on the one hand, he admires the individualism of the Americans and the Puritans. But in that particular instance, particularly in the education context, the Wissenschaft context, the academic context, they're obviously a bit behind the times. And so, of course, he does say in a German context, in a modern education system, he says quite emphatically, oh, well, of course, this is a specialized system. As I said, we can come back to this point where he accepts the idea. This is a specialized system. However, nonetheless, the fact that this is a specialized system does not mean the people in it don't have values. The student, for example, is a poor relation in the German system, Weber thinks, not unreasonably perhaps, Weber is very sensitive to the fact that a student in a German system, I suspect most of the systems, is obviously in a very, very hierarchical situation, where, you know, clearly the important thing is to hear what the professor has to say, and then reduce it accurately, rather than tell the professor he or she is only wrong. So what Weber says then, he said, well, what we as professors cannot do is that we cannot give our values to the student. That would be utterly wrong. But he nonetheless, alas, while obscure, he says, well, the student must nonetheless have values. Where do they get it? He says, in the struggle with life itself. Now that obviously is not actually in practical sense a very helpful answer. It nonetheless is theoretically quite important to tell you that Weber says, you know, you can talk as much as you like about rationalization, technification, but you know, there is still this plural sea of values out there nonetheless, and that's very, very important. And, well, in fact, of all the strata of the education system, of course, Weber is looking for values. Clearly, he himself, as a professor, is quite explicit and not remotely value neutral. When he says, of course, I personally affirm Wissenschaft as my vocation, that is a value commitment. And you know, and it's easy to read that text, so don't thank heaven we found out what he really believes in. Yeah, correct, not vocation, hard vocation. But the point is, if I may say, so in 2014, which I think it's a self-evident point, and yet, perhaps it must be said. Actually, you know, why are we in this business? You know, without wishing to be preachy about it, you know, how important is it to us? You know, is it an absolute definite commitment? Let's be honest, human nature what is, it cannot be for all people an absolute definite commitment. But nonetheless, I mean, you know, we must not be preachy or censorious about that, but nonetheless, this is the idea. And the non-value neutral Max Weber, I think, is the correct idea. The third point is not just that people are driven by values, but the academic arena should, as far as Weber is concerned, be not so much the anarchy of values, but in his own phrase, the struggle of ideals. He says, for example, you know, I am proud that doctoral pupils from my seminar have represented every conceivable standpoint in life. In the extreme agrarian, perhaps the right to the extreme left. And again, this is quotation 3 to the list, not last quotation 2 in the hot pile. Quotation 3. The highest ideals which move us most powerfully work themselves out across all time only in conflict with other ideals, which are just as sacred as our own. And you can see, in fact, how close that is, in fact, to all we do is. You know, if for a moment you sort of have an enlightenment and go back to J.S. Mill, clear. Even Mill thought that it was the clash of ideas that produced correct solutions. True, Mill being who he was in a different generation thought, of course, in the end, he always would produce correct solutions. But the idea that we found actually the clash of these sort of ethically vigorous personalities is absolutely crucial. You can see that is quite authentic liberalism. But Weber's taken it, nonetheless, to a new place. And indeed, I would say that's what he always does. You know, he takes, in fact, quite recognisable conventional ideas, and then, in fact, you find you're going somewhere else. So, on the one hand, this academic enterprise has got to be power values. But on the other hand, as I'm sure you all, 99% of you know, who've read Science Education, know perfectly well that nonetheless there's a trick here. Because these people fired up, you know, who want to have the sharpest conceivable conflicts of views and ideals, must nonetheless practice something called value freedom. And this is the point, of course, at which people like Ernst Troeltsch just totally throw up their hands in horror. How can you have someone who, as Weber obviously was a passionately, ethically committed man, who was at the same time preaching value freedom? How can you have value commitment and value freedom? I mean, Troeltsch, you know, and all the devils, they're just sort of, well, yeah, what is this? And that's why I said, Troeltsch says, having said his ignorance, which I said I admire the man's honesty, said, well, you know, so he's a heroic skeptic. Irrelevant means value commitment, and skeptic means value freedom. Now, so basically, what is the other idea? What is value freedom about? And the first thing to say again is, as usual with Weber, there is, as far as he's concerned anyway, a deep historical root. And the deep historical root, as I said, I'm sure it's all history, but the deep historical root, as far as he's concerned, is that Wissenschaft, the pursuit of learning, the communication of learning, the application of learning, has always, always been an independent enterprise. But apart from its own simple values view of the promotion, as far as Weber's concerned, Wissenschaft is not a source of values. Again, famously, for Science Education, I'm sure you all know this, can, according to Weber, Wissenschaft teach you how to live? It cannot. Wissenschaft is not a source of values. So you can see straight away that once you've said that, and in fact, actually you've opened the door for science being valuable, you see the science is not an intrinsically evaluative activity. So what Weber is actually positing is, of course, that the individuals who take part in this chart are indeed driven by full commitment, but they are, of course, in a sphere, I'm sure you all know this, they are in a sphere which is, in fact, not a sphere which is to do with the negotiation of values. It is not trying to create converts. Curiously, nonetheless, Weber, being sort of the very, very ethical man he was, even value freedom does in fact have profound ethical imperatives attached to it. I remind you, in fact, again, Diego mentioned this, Weber talks of, for example, the elementary duty of academic self-control. Oh, Lord. That's a pretty tall order. That said, we're definitely dealing with ethical imperatives here. In the first instance, that means the professor should not bully students and try and persuade them of his or her point of view. But it also means, in research, the academic should not bully the facts. Not only, of course, the duty of self-control, but again, the duty, this is what Diego mentioned, the duty to observe intellectual honesty. This is a wonderful term, Rechtschaffenheit, being properly constituted. So, you know, honesty, integrity, uprightness, there are no limits possible to commentations, I think. And Weber goes so far the one core element in all authentic worldviews. You know, he says there's this huge plurality of worldviews in the modern day. But if it's authentic, then it's honest. That's the one thing they all have in common. So there was that one universal value, curiously. We can pursue these points further, but you know, time being such that we want to rush on at great speed. But if you look, for example, at quotation 4, you can see what the functions of value-free Wissenschaft are, which is precisely to work out all the possible alternatives. And furthermore, in the most extreme, was they the logically perfect form. Again, it's very important. Value-free academic inquiry, according to Weber, is not just, you know, circles, in fact, you know, the empiricist just goes off and reads the source and re-describes it. That's nonsense. A value-free science is a science that can only operate with the most profound consciousness of value, morality, and value conflict. Another aspect of value freedom, which I feel, again, in this year 2014, in the 21st century, we should discuss, is, so what has this all got to do with relationships versus the state? And again, a rather interesting point, I think it's, maybe read the text, it's transparently obvious, but the doctor doesn't make this point. As a matter of fact, as far as they are concerned, the message that the bona fide academic addresses to the student and the message he or she addresses to the politician are exactly the same. Yes, the student elects all, and the politician in the cabinet room should be addressed in exactly the same way. I'm not quite sure whether, in fact, it's a total risk of success. But as I said again, you can't help but admire the man's ethical integrity. And also, being said, of course, the fact that this is a worked out position. Clearly, one well known issue that concerns him is an apparently very simple one. Protection of academic freedom in universities, and specifically the German language universities. This involves the case of Robert Michels, who is a syndicalist, and is unwise enough to support the progressive motive fact as a syndicalist. And Weber, obviously, as is well known, says, well, you could say, and a lot of people do say during the year 1980, that the German university system is the greatest in the world. And finally, stand back from that moment as a historian, I think we all have to admit it probably was the greatest university system in the world. But nonetheless, Weber says, you know, it cannot function unless all views are represented, including the most extreme. In fact, it's precisely the most extreme views you have to have. So, of course, he comes out with a very suitably derisory estimate of what is the state of value freedom in the intellectual freedom in Germany, in German universities in 1980, which is perhaps a term of exaggeration. You can see, as if he has made, in the political context, he's made the same point he wants to make in the lecture. On this heading, I put in question quotation. The first sentence of which, taken in isolation, is truly glorious. As if you take the first sentence of isolation, it says, how, on the one hand, are professors allowed to make basically political messages? And, on the other hand, can you expect us to trade servants of the state? That is a sublime, audacious thing to say. Yes, how can we be political institutions and expect to train political servants? It's unthinkable. That's what they would say. But then, of course, the punchline comes, well, of course, the only way we could do that was if we were a religious institution, because the only authentic source of values is in religion, not in politics. But now, listen, that first sentence, you know, you can have that on your board. That is, for sheer audacity, has a lot to be said for it. year 2014. We should try and confront the brutal modern world we live in. Or if you like, each of the most important problem facing the German universities, particularly in the ethics of its personnel for Weber, was not in fact the threat to intellectual freedom. He knew perfectly well Michels was a marginal case, and the breadth of opinion generally represented in the universities was very great. He was much, much more worried about the fact that basically academics, you know, were becoming ethically slack. In other words, he was concerned, and again, I think we must be quite honest about this, with a problem that, in other terms, admittedly, but a problem we can recognise, which is the commercialisation of academic life, the monetarisation of academic life. When I said, why are we in this? You know, is it because we think that the corporate universal activity of Wissenschaft is what it's about? Or is it just to increase our salary, or probably not just to increase our salary, but to increase our salary and our ego simultaneously? That is an entirely different value position. And you know, if we're going to take the moral high ground, then I'm afraid Vegas is the only one in town. Nonetheless, as I said, just to prove Vegas' validity, I've got quotation 6 for you. Actually, you can turn over the page. Very advanced. It's a very, very long quotation. I thought it was good. But this is Weber's understanding of what might be a commercial threat from the state in 1909. And Weber thought that what would happen is the state would corrupt universities by swamping them with such shed loads of money that in fact they would weaken on the matter of you know, what political convictions they would bear to teach. He thought the state would actually buy its way to universities and such colossal sums of money that you know, the university wouldn't mind you know, teaching, shall we say, quite important. Well, let us be honest, by the standards of 2014, was he wrong? Was he big time? It is very interesting that I think, again, all people in some of the experience they have may correct me here, I think I'm right in saying that there is very little legitimacy attaching to state incursion of intellectual freedom. And states undoubtedly do try to do that, but it has very little legitimacy. And in that sense, what we might call, not merely the Weberian perspective, but the classical perspective on Wissenschaft, learning, scientia, back to many universities, is upheld. Nonetheless, as I think we all know perfectly well, the fact that states do not try to overtly tarnish our intellectual integrity does not mean states do not think that money is valuable, because of course it is. But of course they use it in a way that Weber did not expect. They do not try and buy academic consciences. They simply say, well, either you can fund this project or you can't. And I thought I'd just throw that in just to prove, you know, although this man is, I think, in many ways a very far-sighted and very clear thinker. Yes, he did not have the gift of prophecy, and indeed he was very, very hostile to the idea of the gift of prophecy. Well, I could go on for every day. You know, so the same of lecture is there. But, what I would like to say by way of conclusion, therefore, is, however hastily and sketchily, what I've tried to offer you is a sense of how, in this particular sector, Weber has offered a negotiation between certain sorts of traditional and apparently universal values, such as we should all be ethically committed, absolutely, or indeed the idea of Wissenschaft as an intact sphere on its own. There's been a negotiation between preserving those sorts of traditional values and the forces, the disintegrative forces of modernity. So Weber has obviously recognised and accepted specialisation. Specialisation is simply mean, well, it's not simple at all. Sexualization is something you have to live with. Every day of your life, you should wake up in the morning and look at yourself in the mirror and say, I must not simply be satisfied with simply saying, well, this is my little patch. That is the second-rate solution. Again, obviously, most obviously of all, of course, Weber is acknowledging there is no such thing as eternal truth. Because what drives truth? Values. Are values mutable? Yes, they are absolute in the time of the person who holds them, but they are mutable. Therefore, by definition, truth is only ever, to use another of his words, valid. In other words, if you, he's saying this, if you give me the value premise, then indeed he doesn't see too much problem in working out empirically what that means. But, he says, of course, the value is going to change, so there is no such thing as eternal truth. In these ways, therefore, he is negotiating in what I would like to suggest to you is, well, ideally, a way which preserves as much of the ideal dignity of Wissenschaft as you can, alongside as much realism as you absolutely have to have. Thank you very much.